Stanky Joe's music changed my life.
I may not agree with this message, but Stanky Joe was a cultural force.
Oh, that band, they had some sweet grooves. Always enjoyed their tunes.
I don't think that popular music today would exist without Stanky Joe. He's a genius.
Riders of the storm. Riders of the storm.
Stanky Joe, born Joseph Bernard Sanders, grew up in a rundown home on the outskirts of San Francisco.
Joe never liked to talk about his childhood, but from what we could grasp, it was pretty whack.
Joe thought playing music at the local pub could help him provide for his family. At the age of 15, he snuck into a small music store, looking to snag himself a guitar.
Really makes you think.
What you doing, boy? You sit your ass down.
You know what, kid? Why don't you just keep that? You make some music now, all right?
Oh, okay.
He did not know it, but the shopkeeper's act of generosity was a fateful moment in the history of music. Joe soon met the members of his band at the Axe Murderer, San Francisco's seediest pub. Their impromptu performance was a big hit, and the band started playing at other venues throughout the city. The band's cheery atmosphere, along with Joseph's heavy stench of manure and cannabis, led the group to call themselves Stanky Joe and the Sunbeams.
Dude, after a few groovy jams, the big man hit us with that deal.
Sign here. No need to read the contract. I'm sure we'll get along fine. Just sign it.
After signing a deal with John Bergman of Uppercase Records, the Sunbeams started on their first album. Their first hit single, Lovin' Naturally, swept the nation.
This album was a real classic.
Before my wife kicked me out of the house, we used to listen to this album all the time.
Following the huge success of their first album, the Sunbeams were put into the spotlight. They released their huge follow-up, Take a Whiff, in the spring of 1966. Much more ambitious than the first project, Joe was obsessed with getting every note right.
Not good enough. You gotta feel the emotion, you gotta feel the vibrations.
But I've been here for 5 hours. What more do you want from me?
Come on, man! Look at your eyes! Look at your soul! What do I see? Nothing. You gotta really feel the music. You gotta think about it. You need to be the music.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Every new take,
I'm subtracting $100 from your pay. Okay? Get that?
Are you kidding me? That's ridiculous.
You think I'm joking?
Yeah, I do. By the time the album was finished, I owed Stanky Joe $3,000.
Take a Whiff was a massive success, topping the charts through the summer of love. The Sunbeams had broken through the California scene and became household names across the whole country. Scent of Earth, the Sunbeams' 1968 all-acoustic album, and Peculiar Odor, The 1969 laid-back psychedelic rock epic also smashed the charts.
So everyone always talks about his first album, or Take a Whiff, or Peculiar Odor when they mention Stanky Joe, but personally, like, I don't think you can get much better than The Scent of Earth. It's music at its rawest and primal form, and it has that kind of rhythm and melody that penetrates you deeply, like Bill.
It's estimated that the members of Stanky Joe and the Sunbeams dropped more acid in 1 month than was ever or has ever been consumed in the state of Wyoming. From 70 to 72, the Sunbeams embarked on a journey to find their purpose.
The Himalayas, dude, they just vibrate with this energy, this power, this ancient polar force of nature. They go on, up and up into the heart of the sky, man.
With the help of a personal Sherpa, all four of the Sunbeams engaged in daily meditation. Stanky Joe, in particular, wanted to become the next enlightened Buddha. The next Sunbeams album took an entire year to produce. During this time, Stanky Joe was never seen or heard from. In 1974, Olfactory Revelations was released.
I just don't get it. Peculiar Odor was so good, so groovy. What happened?
If you play a certain part of the album backwards, the bongo beat plays a message reading, "Follow me into the mountains to achieve enlightenment."
The haters just don't get it, man. Olfactory Revelations, it's not for everyone. You need to have a certain kind of intelligence to really vibe to this music.
Despite a small cult following, the Sunbeams' fifth album barely went silver at 23,000 sales. Devastated, record executive John Bergman decided the band needed some discipline to get back on track. Stanky Joe and the band retreated to a secluded studio in the Sierra Mountains along with Bergman in order to crank out some serious successful music.
The big man was whack, man. Harshing our vibes with all that fat cat square nonsense, man.
To recoup the losses from the failed Olfactory Revelations, Bergman licensed Lovin' Naturally to a car insurance TV advertisement. He also urged the band to go more mainstream by adding funk and disco influences to their music.
Look, buddy, we need to talk.
Yeah? What is it?
Well, your last album sold like garbage. We're not gonna make any money with trash like that!
Trash? What are you talking about? All 127 minutes of that note? That was beautiful, that was art! You don't understand that!
It was absolute garbage! No one's gonna listen to bullheck like that! Now you listen here. I'm gonna tell you what sells. What sells is something with a good, clean beat. What sells is disco.
Oh, I ain't playing no disco!
So I'm gonna tell you what you're gonna play, and it's disco! Disco is the way of the future.
On November 19th, 1974, Stanky Joe asked Bergman to have a private chat about their next album. He brandished a shovel and reportedly said,
"You've been bleeding us dry for so many years. Now it's time to make you bleed.
You'll regret this." I'll rip off your legs and make you play disco for the rest of your life!
Disco's totally whack, man.
You'll never defeat me. Without me, you'd be nothing. You remember that shopkeeper that gave you that guitar all those years ago? That was me! I planned this all along!
No! This can't be true!
Turn over!
Most people think that Joe snapped because of a bad acid trip, but it was probably the secluded mountain environment and Bergman's constant pressure. I mean, the acid didn't help either, but it was mainly those two factors.
The stank was something else, dude. Down in the garage, man, it's like a cow died in there, dude. Not good for the vibes.
In December of 1976, in the middle of a recording session, Tallahassee told Joe that he wanted to take a break from the band.
Whoa, wait. Come on, guys, what's going wrong? Go, you guys, keep playing. Come on, guys, why don't we stop playing? We was just getting stanky.
I'm just not into the music anymore, man. I just want to see my family.
But the album ain't done there, boyo. Okay? We gonna get it done?
I know it's not done. We haven't finished a single song because no take is good enough for you. I gotta head out.
Fine. Playing bass ain't even that hard. How about we help you pack up the van?
Sure, fine.
At least it's worth the Vietnam War. But you ain't never gonna leave, boy! Woo!
Oh my God!
Woo!
Shortly after incapacitating Stanky Joe, Giuseppe called the police. All four members of the band made it out alive, but carried permanent mental scars. In 1980, Joseph Saunders was sentenced to life in prison for multiple counts of assault and murder, while Rick was sent to a mental institution.
Many Stanky Joe fans speculate that the murders were conducted by the government in order to frame Stanky Joe. Although he fully supported the Vietnam War, he had some other very controversial views, like his desire to create a world government so that he could better prepare the world for an alien invasion.
Thankfully, 14 years later, in 1994, President Bill Clinton pardoned Stanky Joe of all charges.
So no one knew where he was after he was released. Some say he lived alone in a house in Alaska. Some say he got plastic surgery and started making country music under the name Toby Truxton. Wherever he is, the assassins from the Bush administration aren't able to find him.
Despite his crimes, Stanky Joe remains one of the defining figures of 20th century music. Historians recall his tremendous cultural power in the same breath as the Beatles, Vanilla Ice, Flavor Flav, Kenny G, and UB40. His influence will certainly never be forgotten. Remember, dear viewer, never use recreational drugs, and always read your record contract before signing. Thank you for watching. And have yourself a very stanky evening.
I love boys.